Let's start with the first two lessons. My conversation with Bill and Thomas started very much like it ended, with a focus on people. What Bill and Thomas described was more than just management by walking around. They talked about how developing trust was essential to effective project management, both in good times and in hard times. They also discussed how large projects involve standardized processes, but how those processes are assessed and managed may be unique from one phase to another, or from one large project to another. When we come back, we'll talk about the next two lessons, which involve assembly, integration, and test, and the challenge of first-time builds. See you shortly. Thomas, Bill, welcome to the NASA Virtual PM Challenge. Thanks for joining us today. Let's jump right in with the first lesson. Lesson one has to do with focusing on people. Focus on people in order to prevent mistakes and their consequences. Bill, can you talk a little bit about why this lesson is so important?
Yeah, I'll give you some ideas. Again, I think, you know, what we'll talk about today is, you know, there's the formal way of doing program project management, and we can't neglect that and forget the formal things that we need to go do. Follow the 7120 processes, the standards are there, the processes are there. Those are all really important to follow. But I think what Thomas and I are going to try to give you a chance today is to think about some of those other things that are beyond kind of the published things, and things that can make the difference between a project being successful and having problems. And the first one you described is actually the paying attention to the people. So not just looking at the metrics and look at the data, but actually spending the time with the teams, interacting with the teams, you know, interacting with them, seeing what's going on, spend some time on the floor in a non-confirmational way where you can actually see what's going on. And then you could pick up cues about what's happening in terms of performance and how things are working. You get a chance to see who key players are, who, you know, it may be there's a certain hierarchy listed on the paper for all the folks, but then you'll get a chance when you go on the floor, see the actual work being done or interact with a team in a program or project review. You'll see who the real leaders are and who you can really ask questions. So that first one is kind of go above and beyond. Don't treat it as a cold system that you just look at with just hard metrics. Actually spend the time to get involved with the program, look under the hood, interact with the people, interact with the program project managers so you really know what's going on with the program or project.
I really believe it's exactly head on, right? And for me, the issue about people is like we all believe in reporting chains. You know, like we all know how direction comes and how information gets propagated. What we're talking about is over and above that. Mm-hmm. I love meeting people. Yesterday, I spent time on the floor with technicians of one of our big flagship missions. And what I do there is I basically asked how are you doing? Frankly, what the person says is probably very good, but I'm watching. Yeah. I also ask, hey, in the last week or so, what's the most important challenge you had, for example? You know, kind of at the beginning, when I meet somebody, I talk about that. When it's a young leader, I might ask, hey, look, I get all the information about this project that I should get. But as a young leader, especially if the project has been in trouble, which happens from time to time. In my case, and with James Webb, we've had others. You know, I might ask you, tell me, in what way, if I was there, kind of a fly on the wall, how would it feel differently today than before when we got into trouble? Where, of course, the processes were the same. That, you know, we wrote down everything just the same way. We got the nice reports. We all had ties on when we met each other. But the point is, it didn't work because the information, we neglected the fact that there are people in there, and frankly, the culture was not aligned top to bottom. The only way to figure that out, yeah, we believe in reporting chain, but we believe in flow of information even more. We want to understand what's there and really make sure that we all have the same kind of playing cards and the same sense, kind of the sincerity and the belief, and also the understanding and alignment behind the vision of the particular program or project we're working on.
So for the project manager, this is really a chance for them to put data, metric data, in context by talking directly with people.
Yeah, I think definitely so. You know, that gets talked about as kind of management by walking around, but it's maybe even a little more deeper than that. It's actually just spending time on the floor and interacting and understand what's really going on in the project.
Because I imagine it also sends a very powerful signal to the project team members to see their management with them on the floor.
Yeah, I think they see that there's a real interest in what they're doing and what's being done that also translates into extra performance. I think, again, just the ability, I think maybe you discount the fact, but just the presence of a senior manager or a program manager, someone that maybe doesn't normally show up in kind of a non-confrontational manner, you know, maybe when things are still going well and they're not, you know, in the bad situation, that sends a powerful message that you're really concerned about what they're doing. And if you listen and you get feedback, you can quietly mention that to mid-level managers, to other program managers about some things that, hey, I heard some things that we might be able to improve. And if the team sees that you're actually going to bat for them and you're stepping up, you're going to get even more response from them when you ask them to do something hard, to work weekends or work nights or to do something that's a little bit above and beyond, or maybe you got to actually work a little harder than the instructions say. And I think if that kind of personal relationship really can build a lot of goodwill that really helps you through the tough situations.
Do you mind if I just tell you kind of some instances where that mattered? And it especially has to do with the times where it's hard. Mm-hmm. So sometimes we have to make decisions that are really hard. Like we put the foot down and we had a mission, for example, where I basically told the entire team, there's exactly one option you have left. You either deliver or kind of the sloppy way of talking about it, or we put the instruments in a museum because they're never going to go where they was designed to be because you have that option, and we're going to perform together. Now, what I did with that is actually affect the lives of many people, right? I did it not because I like to be rough or tough. The situation actually was, and I made the assessment with all the stakeholders that I knew and that I talked to, that this was really the case. Right, so it's like that was a really thoughtful evaluation that came ahead of that. But I changed these people's lives. Well, what's really important to me now is, in this case, the team delivered. What was important to me in this case was even an international team. I showed up at the factory floor to thank them afterwards. And actually, in this case, was my only French speech so far on the job, right? Because I basically sat there and thanked them and recognized, you know, having built hardware, both of us have done this, right? Having built hardware, basically being on the floor ourselves, going to integration test, recognizing this is a hard life, and it really stresses your family if you're there on Christmas Eve or whatever holiday, your summer break that you're spending in the lab. I've been there, done that. I know how it feels. So just thanking them for it. So it's also that part, right? It's yes, understanding what's going on, but also really treating them like people. I tell you, I would go at bat for that team now because I met them, and also because they recognize, frankly, they would do the same. Like I got tremendous feedback for some of these technicians that normally, you know, they're seen as on TV or on some box when they deliver the instrument. Otherwise, they don't see it. And they will go at bat. The CEO wrote me this letter that said exactly that, right? You know, next time we'll not do this again. We are really committed to giving the attention early on, and we understood. Mm-hmm. And what you did there mattered. So it's, I mean, we have these stories, many of us, yeah. But it's the whole thing. It's not just being the hard. It's not, you know, being hard when it's there. It's also the other side. It's really dealing with people like people, because ultimately that's the only way we're going to be successful.
Yeah, and I can give another example. Is, you know, as the shuttle program was winding down, one of the first projects to end was the external tank work in Michoud. So I went down on the day when most of the work was going to be stopping, and I went around to each workstation on all three shifts, and I went with the CEO of the company that was managing the activity, and I met individually with all the employees and thanked them for what they've been doing and told them we needed to move forward. You know, it was really hard for me to do this, but the feedback was amazing from the employees. They were like, okay, we understand. And I explained to them why the external tank was the first project that had to get wound down on shuttle. That allowed the funding to go to Kennedy, who could process the vehicle and actually go fly the shuttle. So essentially, we didn't have enough funding to keep running at the same level, so the program had to phase out in pieces. So once they understood why they were being the first ones to kind of ramp down and essentially have to find a new place to go work with uncertainty. They understood that, and then they really accepted that, and they continued to deliver all the way through. Their message back to me was, you know, a lot of time after the hardware gets delivered, we find problems with the hardware, and you need us to come back and go work on it. What are you going to do for that? And I explained to them, well, I wasn't sure what I was going to do. And they told me, well, we're going to get other jobs, but we'll make ourselves available. So if something comes up, you can come back to us, and we'll come off the other job and come back and finish what we needed to on this external tank that's down in Florida being processed. And it turned out we had to do that. We had to go back. The companies they were working for actually gave them time off from their new jobs, allowed them to come back and go work on our hardware. So it's, you know, it seems trivial sometimes, but I think making that personal touch and explaining to folks why you're asking them to do the hard things and getting their feedback and then interacting with that feedback and giving it back to them really builds a strong high-performance team.